One, two. Turned off on you. Did you unplug it by chance? There it goes. Okay. Hey, hey. One, two. One, two. Good level.
Hello, for a second. So funny. Hello. Hello. Can?
Yeah.
Can you hear me now? Good. Okay, raise your hand in the back if you can hear me.
How about here?
Some people didn't.
Enough did,
yeah. Can't please everybody. Good to go? You could use that.
Thank you
very much.
Thanks to the AV guys. Woo! So this is the Macintosh Operations session. They very aptly said Macintosh Operations on their first slide. I'm actually really excited to hear how Google supports the joy of Mac. It's, you know, fun. So Clay Caviness and Edward Eigerman, I'm not going to take any more of their time.
Excellent. So we're Clay Caviness and Edward Eigerman from the Macintosh Operations team at Google. We're going to talk about how we manage our fleet of Macs. We have one of the largest managed fleets in the world, if not the largest managed fleet in the world. We're going to go over the basic tools we use, how we get things done, and tell you a story about seven little engineers. And this is their story. They were grumpy, bashful, sleepy, dopey, happy, sneezy, and doc. And this is the Macintosh operations team. We live in a magic castle in New York City, except for one of us who lives in a magic castle in Mountain View, California. So we're mostly centered in the New York City office, where we're part of Google's corporate engineering team, which is essentially our IT department, and which is based out of New York. There was a time when Macs were a small part of the Google fleet. But as of now, if you start at Google and you want to use a platform other than Mac, you have to make a business case for Mac or Linux.
So we support four different desktop OSs internally. There's obviously, we're just talking about Mac OS X here, also Windows.
Volume.
I don't know how to adjust the volume. It's a magic thing. We'll move it up.
If you're going to turn your head to one side.
We'll try that.
Better.
Yeah.
There we go. Is that better?
Yes.
All right. So Mac, Windows, Linux, and Chrome OS. So that's all. Oh, this is the different one. I'm used to this one.
Yeah. So you are.
So we have about 64, you know, official offices, if you look on our website, and they really span the range of tiny little, you know, one- and two-person offices to, you know, Mountain View campus. New York offices is very large, Dublin, Hyderabad, all over the place. The people in those offices, and those offices support sort of very different services and losing my train of thought here. Functions and business models. We have 42,162 permanent employees, according to the SEC filing we made in Q3.
Those are three of them.
We have, this doesn't include motor mobility, as you probably imagine. And there's quite a few contractors, temps, vendors as well. So this all means we have tens of thousands of Macs. I looked this morning. This is an actual picture of our Macs. We looked. I think. Well, this is probably. This is yesterday. It was 43,207 30-day actives, which is that's a little bit more precise than is actually possible, but 43,000-ish, a lot.
So MacOps are the DevOps team charged with keeping those machines secure and up and running and getting stuff done for our users. This is a slide I presented last year at a Mac conference, Mac Tech, which actually is going on right now in LA. And I liked it so much I thought I'd present it again. But basically, we don't use any of Apple's tools to manage the Macs. Apple arguably produces two tools. Mac OS X Server, which is essentially a bunch of applications which run on top of Mac OS, but of course they don't produce any server hardware, and Apple Remote Desktop, which is a sort of Swiss Army knife of remote management tools. It does remote control, remote software pushes, some basic inventory, you can do remote UNIX commands, anything like that you want to with the with it. It kind of breaks down when you get over 50, 100, 200 machines that you're managing. And this is a slide to illustrate. This is the version number of Apple Remote Desktop over the last 10 years. And they haven't had a major revision to it since 2006. The red line represents the release of the iPhone. So we've sort of lost their attention as far as enterprise management tools. So we either build or use open source products to do all of the management that we need to do, or almost all of it. We use one or two commercial products. The environment in which we work is very security conscious, obviously, very privacy conscious. We also have a very strong bias towards open source. That's generally the first place we look if we want to do anything. If we don't find an open source tool, we have a very strong bias to building our own tool if we can. We are trying as hard as we can to move away from the corporate network as a thing. There was a talk yesterday that Jan Mancha and Harald Wagner gave on moving outside the corporate perimeter as a security model, which was awesome. And Greg, who's going to follow us, will be talking about that, not in so much depth, but he'll be talking a little bit about how we're trying to do that. So our goal is that all our tools should work on the internet, not only on the Google network. We are very strong bias towards putting the latest OS on all our machines. We generally feel that the security improvements as the OS goes along outweigh the niggling little bugs that will catch us from moving too quickly. We moved from 10.7 to 10.8 in about 8 weeks for 99.5% of the fleet. And we're trying to do the same thing with 10.9 right now. And we have many, many users, and they do various things all over the world. I always like to tell people, whatever it is you do, there's people at Google who do that. From software engineers and SREs to masseuses and chefs. So we support all of these people on the Mac. Our general inventory of the things we like to use most, we like App Engine, obviously, Google App Engine. It's a great tool for spinning up services very quickly, securely, and of course available on the internet. We use Python. The Mac Ops department uses Python for almost all the scripting that we do. We're very heavily biased towards it. We use the internet as much as we can. So again, moving away from the trusted corporate network, and of course the cloud. We love the cloud, and we encourage our users to keep their data in the cloud, and we encourage everything to happen in the cloud. So this is just an overall overview breakdown of what I'm about to tell you, the different tasks we have and how we try to get them done, and the products we use. So I'll go through this, or we'll go through this in much greater depth. Imaging, I have no idea why I used a hamburger for this, but there it is. So we produce a single monolithic image for all of the Macs in the Google network, in the Google inventory. We can do this because our other tools, package management and configuration management, are so good. So we can produce a single monolithic image and then customize it individually for users through the other management tools. I'm secretly announcing we're open sourcing the project we use to do this. I'm doing it secretly because I'm not the person who wrote it, so you know, I got to get him to actually submit the code.
We think he's ready.
We think he's ready. He doesn't think he's ready, but we think he's ready. It's going to be called CanHasImage. And essentially, it's a system that will take an Apple. It will take an Apple system image, apply a set of packages to it, and create an image you can use to image your machines. The key goals for us are always reviewability, repeatability, and automation. So we can review as a team what goes into the package through our source control system. We can review the packages themselves. If Apple revs the OS, we can very quickly repeat what we've done and create another image with the same base software on it. And we can do that in an automated process. So those are always our key goals, and we have CanHasImage to do that. We have a global netboot environment for imaging. That's one of the major things that we still do on the corporate network only, obviously. And there's not much to say about it, but it works.
So we have a lot of machines, and they do a lot of different things, and we need to manage them all in some way to make sure that they stay under our control, or at least under that we know they're out there and we can know what's happening with them. So we use Puppet for configuration management. It's probably have heard about Puppet many times in the last week. If you haven't, I don't know if you've actually been in any talks. I'll go over it quickly. It's a sort of a centralized configuration management for Unix-like systems. I think they actually added Windows support recently, anything that runs Ruby. So Ed mentioned we do everything in Python, and we do, except for the parts we do in Ruby that are related to Puppet. And most of us only know Ruby because we know Python, which makes things very complicated. And I only do enough Ruby to get confused about it. It's good, though. I mean, it uses a sibling project called Factor, and that gets a bunch of data about the machine, the state of the machine. It uses that, sends it up to the server along with the machine identifier. Server compiles a sort of a catalog down, applies that locally. So you sort of determine the state of, you sort of define the state of the machine as you want it to be, and Puppet makes that happen. So I'm going to give a few quick examples. None of these are really incredibly valid for specific to Mac, but you know, it's still useful. So the old-fashioned way you would probably make a new user on OS X would be to do a bunch of DSCL commands, you know, add some data, blah, 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 make a home directory. You do all this, it's all kind of fragile. You do it once, you kind of hope for the best. Hopefully nothing breaks later on. In Puppet, you sort of, again, I said, you just tell it what you want. So you say, I want a user named Jebediah, and I want this home directory to be that, and UID, so forth. And I want a directory created called /user/Jebediah that is owned by him and is a directory. And then anytime anything happens to the system that might change this, say the user gets the user account gets deleted, Puppet, next time it runs, we'll just recreate it. If somehow the user UID managed to get changed by some black magic, Puppet will fix that as well. So, and the same thing for the home directory. Any other resource that you define in Puppet. In OS X for service ACLs for SSH and login window and things like that, those are all managed by local groups. So again, with Puppet, we can manage these with just a group resource. We say, these three groups, make sure they exist, and make sure that the membership of those groups is root and primary user. Primary user is just generated descriptively on every host. It's just the main user of that machine. So we need to apply public configurations no matter where you are on the network. Right now, we're doing the sort of standard Puppet master client machine, send the stuff up, get it back. That's a little more complicated if you want to do sort of a beyond corp setup. So since everything's very mobile, most of our fleet is laptops, we have to figure out a different way to do this. So the idea is you have the clients pull down the manifest directly and then apply them locally. It's easier to solve the download a file and then do stuff with it than it is to set up a reverse proxy from the clients on a random network through the reverse proxy into the host, because Puppet's Ruby and it's complicated, and who wants to do that? So we're moving to this. Some of the teams internally have also done this. Most of the Linux machines do this. We're moving to this now with the work in progress. We use another tool called crankd. It's a Python script. It basically registers for system events, like the system configuration events, Cocoa events like init's workspace style notifications. We use it for things like anytime the network state changes, you go on or off a network, we can figure out if you're on the corporate network, which doesn't matter as much anymore, but we still care in certain places. You know, we can determine if you're on if it's on a VPN of some sort, if you're on a behind a captive portal, if you know, all sorts of things. We can also track from the NS workspace changes. We can look for application launches and quits. So anytime an application starts or exits, we can do something with that. We can, in this case, we're just logging it for usage, which is good for licensing and other security people. Security people like everything logged. Greg will tell you that. You can do anything with scripting, sure. So the network state change, I'm sort of talking about it here. The network state change is just this system configuration file. In the crankd plist, the configuration file, you sort of tell it, I want to listen to this system configuration key, this system configuration notification. And every time you see this, you call the on network state change method inside of the network state change class. Just sort of how crankd was set up. Inside the actual class, it looks something like this. I tore this apart and simplified it. This isn't actually what goes on. So we, in this case, every time there's network state change, we log the Wi-Fi information for science later. Then, you know, we check if we're on a captive portal. If we are, then we have a program that launches an incognito Chrome window that you can then go to log on to your captive portal. If not, then we just say, well, check and see if Puppet needs to be run, check and see if the inventory managers need to be run. And this sort of gets a better coverage from, you know, beyond just having the Puppet and inventory management tools run periodically, which we have already. It's good to have other things sort of poking them occasionally to make sure something got broken, start them up again. So users do terrible things. So we had a user once describe Puppet as a virus to a team mailing list, and describe a bunch of ways to disable it and work around it and that sort of thing. And you know, that's not good. This was a few years ago. I think it changed their tune somewhat. So we don't really want that. And on the flip side, we also occasionally do terrible things. Some configuration change, you know, slips past the testing, and we've broken something. So we also have, and we suggest having, some sort of backup system, basically a watchdog for all of your management tools. In our case, we wrote something called Plan B, which is just a shell script. So we did shell because we've seen cases where the system Python or the system Ruby frameworks are broken in strange and bizarre and horrible ways. So we want a way that, you know, we have the shell, and if a shell is broken, then nothing is working. So we wrote this. It runs periodically, checks if the management agents have reported success in the last, you know, day or three. I forget what our current timeout is. And if it hasn't, then it tries to download the packages and reinstalls and tries to fix them and start them over again. So this is sort of like the sort of an ongoing watchdog that watches everything else. We don't have anything that watches the watchers, but you know, maybe later.
So we'll talk a little bit about software package management. So we use three open source projects to manage the sort of our software lifecycle from beginning to end. The first is the luggage. The luggage is an open source project which allows you to use makefiles to create Apple package installers. It's great because it's reviewable, repeatable, and automated. So we can create a makefile for a given application. Even if the application revs, usually you can drop the new version in and just run the makefile again, and you get an identical package with a new version number, which we can put in production. And again, the team can review them. This is a sample one you can't possibly read from the Git page for the luggage. But basically, it's a set of rules you configure for each given package you're going to use. And of course, we can use it again within our source control system, so we can review the packages and review the make files. The main product we use for getting the software onto user machines is called Monkey. It's an open source project out of Disney Animation in LA, and it's awesome. The client end is made to look like Apple Software Update, which was deprecated with 10.8. So it's a little anachronistic at this point, and probably future versions will look like something else, either the App Store or some new thing. But this is what the user sees. It can push Apple OS updates, it can push our own updates, our own software, and one of the best features, it can give each user a list of optional software. So we can prepackage things, users can come into this interface, hit optional software, and they'll get a package that we've okayed for whatever given thing they want to install. The back end of Monkey just looks for an HTTP server, basically. So we built a back end on Google App Engine called Simeon, and this is an open source project that's been out for a couple of years that our team and a related team work on. And basically, it's a back end for Monkey. It gives you fairly fine-grained controls for how packages will be pushed out, who will get them. We manage hundreds and hundreds of packages with it without any issues. Again, since it's App Engine based, it works on the internet, not just on Google's network. These are all sample images from the open source page, so a little out of date. But it gives you a basic overview of how we can control packages, whether they'll be installed everywhere or installed where a previous version exists, whether they'll be made available as optional installs. Things can be unattended installs, so an unattended install will install without any user interaction at all. It'll just happen in the background, which is really how we try to do everything if we can, because there's no way to say later. We can also attach a force install date to anything, an Apple package or one of our own packages. And basically, as that date approaches, the user gets more and more frequent notifications. And if that deadline actually passes, they will be logged out. The update will proceed. And if a restart is required, it will restart them. So up to that point, there's hourly notifications. And they are notified that, you know, this will log you out, and you can and will lose data. So it doesn't happen too much anymore. They're used to it now. Shows you can get used to anything. But it's fairly good up-to-date reporting. It shows us that we have 70 Macs. I was told to take the picture I had out here out before. Right. So.
And also the joke that we were going to tell about it.
Yeah,
I didn't want to do that either. Thanks, Greg. So security and monitoring, which is another important piece of the puzzle here. So to protect the data of all the machines we have that are mostly laptops at rest, we want to have them fully disk encrypted. Apple released in 10.7 something called File Vault 2, which was a full disk encryption solution. Previously, they had File Vault 1, which was only volume or only like directory encryption. You could do your home directory, and that was about it, which is kind of pointless and also very fragile. But 10.7 released File Vault 2, which is whole disk encryption. They didn't really have many enterprise tools for managing the escrowing of the keys and so on. So we created Cauliflower Vest, which is an anagram for File Vault Escrow. Created by our team, we open sourced it. So it was a client tool that could actually, before it was before the before Apple actually released it in 10.8, it could actually get the license plate recovery token and ship that up. Apple has since fixed the client to have a method to get that recovery token directly when you enable it. So now it's mostly just the you know, a client to ship it off to an App Engine backend. The best part about this is all of the access to the key is logged and audited. So User forgets their password, the user themselves can get the recovery key, or if someone, an incident response or legal discovery, if someone needs it, they have the ability to get access to the locked hard drive, exit employee, something like that. All of these are logged and audited, which makes all the security and auditing people very happy. Inventory management, we don't have a great story here. Inventory management in most places is kind of a mess. We've cleaned up ours quite a bit. We don't have anything open source really from here because it all sort of ties into various internal back-end infrastructure things. Most of the data we get from Factor. So Factor, again, related to Puppet, generates a bunch of facts about the machine. We have Factor plus a few other sources we tie in. They ship up to actually it's an App Engine receiver, so all of the inventory stuff reports to App Engine. And then that gets shipped off to the various inventory backends we have internally at Google to get managed and sorted and massaged and used. This is our pre-anti-penultimate slide. So summary, so if you have Macs, you should manage them. If you're Unix guys, it's probably, this is Unix, I know this, sort of. It's
whatever you don't know, you don't know.
Yeah, there's a lot of unknown unknowns, we understand. So you start with a good base image. As Ed talked about, you got to manage software packaging, have a good way for users to request and install third-party packages without needing them to go to a tech all the time. Manage all the configuration on there constantly. So we're using Puppet. You need to figure out a way to do this constantly, especially on a mobile fleet where the machines are, on the network, off the network, they're at a hotel, they're at a coffee shop, they're on a plane. And make sure that the security configurations you want are always applied. And with File Vault, you want to encrypt all the things. Just encrypt everything. Encrypt, encrypt, encrypt. Log everything, collect all those logs centrally, and have some sort of watchdog watching your management tools to make sure that if they break, something else can sort of kick them off again. And like I had mentioned at the beginning, make sure everything is reviewable, repeatable, and automated. Keep it all in source control, make sure there's, sort of four eyes looking at everything, and automate everything. You don't want to do something 40,000 times. Maybe if you have 50 Macs, it's not hard to I'll just do this real quick on these ones, but that doesn't scale. So we're large install people, so we all know, just automate everything. And contact us. Those are our email addresses. We have a We have a Google Plus page that we occasionally post stuff on as a team. There's a bunch of links. You can find this stuff pretty easily.
And the one that I forgot to put on here, there's another Ed in our department. So Ed and I run a monthly meeting called Mac Admins Monthly, which we do as a Google Hangout. Or if you're in New York, you can come by, where we talk about current Mac admin issues, what's hot, what's not. And I was going to put a link up there, and I forgot. So, but you can Google it.
I'm in New York State, but I'm only 120 miles north. When do you tend to run?
It's the second Tuesday of every month, and about 4 in the afternoon. But it's a Google Hangout, so if you don't want to make the drive or the walk.
Yeah.
Amtrak.
Yeah. So if there are any questions.
Please use the mic.
Yes.
But there's one question in your
back. I know, it's really misleading, isn't it? It's enough by one ear.
So thanks very much for a very interesting talk. You mentioned some of your users somewhat negative opinion of having Puppet manage their Mac for them. So assuming that you have the independent mad hacker types, but you actually do want to manage them because it is for their own good, how do you get the compromise between Puppet's tendency to, say, alles in Ordnung and users' desire to customize?
But we try to go with a sort of a carrot-stick approach in a way. So like the access to internal network resources is dependent on a machine certificate, and the machine certificate, when you connect those resources, as Jan and Harold spoke about the other day, there's a whole backend system that verifies the machine is up to date. So if they've disabled Puppet and broken the management tools, then the ACL engine is going to say, you can't get anything. Or, you know, if things get bad, we just revoke the machine certificate, and then not much works. It's basically ends up being just a standalone Mac that they don't really have much access to.
And Greg will talk about this a little bit, but we also try to give users an opt-out of anything that we're not, you know, we try to be reasonable about what we absolutely have to do.
Yeah.
And if we don't absolutely have to do some things, or if doing something 95% of the time will mitigate whatever issue we're trying to deal with, we try to give users a way to opt out. Not usually a simple way to opt out, but a way to opt out so that they can... there's always edge cases. With 40,000 Macs, we hit every edge case you can imagine. Mm. So we try to give people as much freedom as we can. So, you know, we try to... we meet them halfway if we can.
Okay, right. Thank you.
Thank you.
So if I read between the lines, are you actually suggesting that Google doesn't have the ability to ask Apple, can you please just make that work? And if so...
Oh, no, no, no. We can ask Apple.
Yeah, we ask them all the time.
We ask them lots of things. And they've actually, I mean, joking aside, they have actually taken a lot of our suggestions. They just move fairly slowly. There's a lot of time we'll say, you know, 10.7 was out, and we're like, oh, this 5-volt 2 stuff is great. Can you give us a way to get the, you know, do this and, swap keys around and that sort of thing. And
okay.
They say, yeah, our engineers will take that under advisement. And then, you know, 6 months later, it's like next major OS. So, you know, a year later, we actually get some sort of...
I mean, the other side of that, we often make the joke. So we're in Chelsea in New York, and we're catty-cornered to the Apple store in the meatpacking district. You know, we're easily one of Apple's biggest enterprise customers. Any given weekend, they sell 3 or 4 times as many Macs at the Apple store than they do sell to us in a year. So... Apple's butter is definitely on one side of the bread, so we can get them to move a little bit, but it can be frustrating.
So you do actually kind of reinvent things like the key management that are coming because you can't risk waiting. You just
we would have had to wait a year. Yeah, we would have had to wait a year if we hadn't done that, and we were eager to get all our machines full disk encrypted. So
yeah, I mean the original 5-volt 1 and or 5-volt 2 and 10.7. You know, you could. You could give a, you know, the security question sort of key encryption blob, ship it up to Apple, and you know they assure us that that's encrypted just by with your challenge response and not like, you know, with some other back key. But I mean, we don't want to, you know, then there's no way for anyone but that person to get it back, and so we need ways for the, you know, the enterprise to actually access those keys for, you know, reasons we mentioned before.
Makes sense.
So a lot of these is like, you know, we have the tools. Apple gives some sort of tools, but there's no sort of like enterprise back end for it. So we have to figure out a way to, you know, write the back end.
Mm-hmm. Very good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
So a couple of quick questions. The first one, hopefully easy. The PyMac admin, is that just about your Python scripting, or which one was that?
So PyMac admin, that's CrankD. So that was actually created by Nigel Kirsten and Chris Adams. Nigel used to work at Google. Now he's at Puppet Labs.
Okay.
So PyMac admin is mostly CrankD. There's a few other scripts in there that were, you know, sort of tangentially related, but that's mostly CrankD.
Okay. Second question, a little possibly more difficult. So you mentioned, you know, you have all kinds of edge cases, which those of us with lots of engineers have. Same thing. So what do you do? And this is basically not a macOS specific question, but what do you do for those, you know, let's call them repeat offenders, where they don't have a business legitimate case for what they're doing? They're repeatedly defeating the controls you're putting in place. Do you, you know, can you take me through some escalations? Like, you know, do you send out, like, you know, you've got a divergence report. I'm going to, you know, I've told you several times. Now I have to, you know, CC your manager. Do you do some things like that?
We try to fix things technically up to a point, but if it doesn't work technically, then it's an HR problem.
Yeah.
Sort of. I mean, you know, we try to, you know, we'll also look at it. If there's a reason they're doing this constantly, maybe there's a workaround we can give them or a knob they can tweak to actually make things work. But if they're just completely obstinate and breaking something that really they shouldn't be breaking, then I mean, we usually end up trying. You know, it doesn't happen very often, thankfully. I can't think.
Well,
really.
Hypothetically, we might have had a user who continually would reinstall the new version of the OS the moment it was released, before we'd approved it, before our management tools would work.
Yeah, here's the 10.8 developer preview, and he's installing it, and suddenly,
right. Yeah, so occasionally, but one thing we didn't talk about, which is kind of unfair, is that, you know, there's 7 of us. We obviously don't do front line tech support, We have an amazing team that does frontline tech support at Google, and we also get them involved with those things too, because there'll be somebody at the office where it's happening who has a personal relationship with the user, or at least knows what they look like or whatever, and that's often a way to move those things forward before we go to the stage of we've CC'd your manager and his VP, but that's if it keeps going, that's where it ends up, is, you know, talking to the manager and up the chain until we get
What did you guys do with the guy who basically got on that mailing list and said, here's a way to actively sabotage the controls?
I think we shamed him and his manager enough that he stopped doing it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Which is fine. Eventually, he was, you know, this hypothetical person was actually, you know, pretty good, you know, about getting us feedback about things that were broken, which usually in the very first developer feed you see, it means almost all of our tools don't work. So usually everything's broken and I can't log in and everything, you know, but it was good about getting feedback. So it was somewhat valuable, but it was coming in too early and sort of out of the system. So,
all right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hi, interesting presentation. How do you manage user preferences and user application data against, you know, hardware failures? Like, you know, if users have a particular application with local preferences, you know, bookmarks and, you know, stuff like that, is that backed up?
No, we trust the users to use the cloud.
Yeah, I mean, typically we use Chrome, right, oddly enough. It's the browser of choice at Google, which backs up its preferences to the cloud automatically. And typically, for other user preferences, we encourage people to use Google Drive, cloud tools, and things like that to keep their own stuff backed up. We don't, at this scale, we don't back up desktops individually. So, and we actively discourage users from keeping important data on their laptops.
So. Okay, so users are kind of responsible for taking their own backups if there's anything that can't be pushed
right
to the cloud.
Yeah.
Right, thanks.
Kind of a follow-up to that. So if you let users keep their own backups, how do you make sure they don't just keep an unencrypted backup that may contain something valuable to the corporation?
So it's very hard to keep users from doing bad things if they really want to. We try to provide guidelines as much as we can about how you should back up. You know, obviously, we encourage everyone to use Google tools, which we trust to be encrypted and to be effective. And we try to keep an eye on what's running on the fleet. So if we see somebody is running like Apple's Time Machine, which we have not been able to force into encrypted mode. So we wouldn't mind people doing that if we can make sure there was always an encrypted disk they were backing up to. So we can keep track of who's using Time Machine, and we can contact them and make sure that they're doing it in a way, or ask them to do it in a way that that will make sure the data stays encrypted. So it's some amount of user trust, which is always scary. But that's basically how we do that.
Yeah, and I mean, there's, like I said, there's no rule. You can't sort of stop users from just plugging a USB drive and backing their stuff up somewhere. I mean, at some point, there's, you know, here are the guidelines of the security policies and management ways we want you to handle these things. Don't be an idiot. This is sort of the, you know, be smart about these things. So we try to do that.
We'll take these last two questions, and then we'll be outside if anyone has any more questions beyond that, because I don't want to hold Greg up.
Okay, so one of your original slides mentioned, hey, there was a nation-state hack, and we had to do dramatic event. And now,
Evil Wizard.
Okay,
yeah.
Well, I Googled it. They called it a nation-state hack. So, but now, and I hear you saying, no, okay, so we used the cloud heavily, et cetera, but now, you know, it's November, and you know the question that's coming, because now you have a hack that so I'm just wondering, you know, what sort of discussions you may have had about possibly changing the paradigm you've got.
Well, I would. I mean, I can't talk about any of that. But I would actually very strongly recommend Eric Gross is our vice president of security. Can I say that? We admit he exists, right? he had some great interviews in the Journal, the Wall Street Journal, where he talked very as specifically as anyone's going to talk about what we're doing to prevent future nation-state attacks, such as may or may not have occurred.
Yes.
And it's really good stuff. It's a great couple of interviews, and he really talks about what how serious Google takes that stuff and what we're going to try to do about it.
All right, thank you. Just I have a question. I'm surprised you have Google Chrome operating system and you're using Mac as your main operating system and this stuff. What's the reason for that behind that?
Why do we use Mac as a main system when Chrome OS exists?
Yes, you have your own.
Chrome OS is young. Like I wouldn't say that we don't want to be running a lot more Chrome OS, but it's young. You know, we have a lot of engineers who are. I mean, we have a huge number of Mac OS engineers. And we have a huge number of iOS engineers. And we have a huge number of people who, it pains me to say this, need to run Microsoft Office. And there's a lot of people out there who have needs that go beyond what Chrome OS can do right now. In the future, I don't know what the breakdown is going to look like. But right now, we have a lot of Chrome OS users, but we just have a lot of users in general. So we have 40,000 Macs.
Yeah, I think the general rule is we let the engineers decide what they need to do their jobs best, and you give them some guidance. But you know, if they really want a Mac or a Linux laptop, I don't know why, or something like that, then you can do that.
Optional for them.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, we just give them the choice to do what they need.
Okay.
Right.
Okay. Thank you very much. We'll be right outside if anyone else has any other questions.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.